Nicholas, or Nick. I'm the Associate Opinion Editor for the Daily Princetonian.
And we're here to have an informal conversation about the role of the free press, media, and democracy, both on campus and how it affects us outside the bubble. So to kick things off, to engage ourselves, we want to go around and have a brief reflection engagement about what could be called a media diet and recognizing our own media diet. So where do you get your news primarily from? Social media, traditional news, non-traditional media sources. Think for a minute about where do you usually go first off to get your news. And we'll go around in circles. Everyone can briefly share your go-to sources for news media. I'll let Nora pick up. You can also say your name.
I'm Nora, and I probably first go to the New York Times. I'm a big fan of The Atlantic. Sometimes I'll just hear. Yeah. There are others, but
I usually read German newspapers, but probably also New York Times for like headlines and then Atlantic.
Oh, yeah. Are you German usually?
Yes,
I'm German. Okay.
I'm Sarah, and I normally go straight to the New York Times or CNN or sometimes normal, less objectively, with the New Yorker.
I'm Yifan, and as with everyone else, I read the New York Times. I recently got a subscription to it, and I got this lofty goal. I read like a third of the articles, which never works out. But I've also, in the past, I've looked at Al Jazeera, but I think they've recently deprioritized English language coverage. Still looking for an alternative to that.
Hi, I'm Lindsay, and I go to the New York Times or the Huffington Post, and Barry, because I'm probably a lot older than people in this room. I go on MSN.com and I scroll headlines just to see what other articles are out there.
Ashley, New York Times, HuffPost, and then Twitter.
Hi, I'm Aaron. When the Onion's not telling the truth. I usually go to the New York Times. I would say that I use Facebook as sort of an aggregator for news sources, but I don't know. If I'm looking for more, I don't know, focused analysis of current policy, then I'm also looking at policy research think tank websites for, like I said, more focused, concentrated content. So.
I'm Cassidy. I primarily used to only follow New York Times, but now I guess there was like this post about different media sources and how they spread across the spectrum of like liberal or conservative, or like how good their journalism is, and I think that affected a lot of where I get my news now. So I'm like trying to read more articles from other sources like NPR or BBC that have less liberal leanings, I guess. And occasionally, sometimes I might read like the Fox News article just to know what it's like.
So I'm Petey. My main go-to is NBC News, and then if I want a contrary viewpoint, or I guess a really right-wing viewpoint, Fox News. And then I'm most embarrassed to say, social media-wise, Facebook, like, headlines and stuff.
When you say NBC events. And Fox, do you mean on TV?
NBCNews.com. It's an affiliate, I guess, of NBC.
Okay.
It used to be MSNBC, but they no longer affiliate with Microsoft, I guess.
Okay. My name is Virginia. I probably get most of my news from NPR. I listen to the radio before work, on my way to work, and then coming home, and watch a lot of Twitter feeds for the social media things that I do at my job, and Facebook as well, but I'm trying to spend less time there.
Also, there's more space to sit over here if you don't want to be on the floor. I need couch space.
Okay. And then, I guess we're doing major sources of news?
Yeah, we're talking about things.
Probably New York Times, Atlantic, and then for social media aggregators, Facebook and Reddit.
Reddit, really
interesting. Okay, so my name is Levi. I guess for a long time I used CNN, but I got kind of satisfied with them. So now I use mainly Reuters and then Google News aggregation app.
My name is Yanni, and I normally read the BBC and NPR and some Atlantic and New Yorker.
My name is Tamara Patton. I guess on the daily it's New York Times, and every morning the BBC World News podcast. And then for the more, I work on nuclear weapon policy issues, so that involves a lot of drilling into the defense blogs and things like the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists, and of course Twitter, where all of the big time experts are constantly putting everything to.
Cool.
Should
we talk about it? All right. If you didn't catch my name the first time around, I'm Nick, and I get most of my news from, I would say, the New York Times, Political Playbook in the mornings, and then the Washington Post.
I'm Sarah, and most of my news comes from friends. So I actually use, shamelessly, Facebook. I use Facebook less now as an actual social media tool, and more of as a news aggregator tool. Everywhere from like the Republican politicians' Facebooks to as liberal as it gets. So I just have everything on my feed. It was sketchy time. People are stalking me at the time, like what I like, but it's like it provides a nice spectrum. I actually did this exercise in my journalism class here at Princeton my freshman year, a media diet. It was a formal assignment. And so ever since then, I've been more conscious of the news I look at. So. Based on this exercise, we can see that there are a lot of commonalities. We have a few like New York Times, big news sources, they're all there. But then also we have a few dissimilar events, whether it's Twitter, Facebook, some people consult social media more, generational differences sometimes, political ideology differences. But I think the underlying trends and also differences are important to look at and also be more conscious of where we go, because they feed into our own biases. And oftentimes we don't recognize our own biases, but it's there. And the way we consume news is important because that affects how we engage in conversations, the policy we want to pursue, the action we take going forward and stay on, and how we engage with other people is critical. If we're only looking at liberal websites on Facebook, we're going to get into Facebook arguments and only engage with one side of the argument. And so it's really important that we just remain conscious, and that's kind of the point of this exercise, to recognize where we go for news and perhaps open our minds up to other news sources. And on the note of social media, because it can be a huge news tool, source of news nowadays, is that
going to? Yeah, so what we're going to do next is we're going to run through this thing called Blue Feed, Red Feed. So some of you have mentioned that you use Facebook or Twitter to talk about where you get your news. But have you ever really considered how exactly Facebook is sorting all of that and how it's sorting all of those links? So what Facebook does is, the site's own algorithm will recognize what kind of things you like and what your friends like, and will serve you things that you're more likely to like and share. So what the Wall Street Journal, you know, obviously not the most bleeding liberal of publications, did was they ran this little study. So which particular policy topic do we want to talk about?
Immigration.
All right, we'll do immigration first. And so what they did was they simulated what a really liberal person's Facebook feed would look like and what a really conservative person's Facebook feed would look like. And so here's what we get. Right. On the left, you know, okay, President Trump's new travel ban will ban immigrants from 6 majority Muslim nations. On the right, here's the process, the death spiral of a free nation. Muslims are the only immigration group that comes to a country with its own ready-made model of society, it wants to be superior, right? And you have like a picture of riots and stuff. As opposed to here, you have like, you know, people hugging in the airport. And as you go further down, Steve Bannon is a fan of like racial superiority. This is applauding the Secretary of Homeland Security, right? The ACLU, Daily Caller, And so the point of this is to show that Facebook sometimes only serves to reinforce the echo chamber. Right? If all you're seeing are incredibly liberal posts about a topic, or if all you're seeing are incredibly conservative posts about it, it's hard to have a much more reasoned conversation or a much more reasoned exchange of facts about any given topic. So here, if we go back, okay, let's pick a different topic. So someone said the ACA they want to talk about?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And yeah, so, okay. Old people like the ACA. ACA got audited, it's losing money. Or Glenn Beck, man, like Obamacare's failing, right? Or from the Daily Coast, very liberal outlet. Paul Ryan's gonna shove a repeal through. Daily Coast. The Affordable Care Act replacement was written by a 25-year-old. Herman Cain sharing something saying that the replacement for the Affordable Care Act will empower consumers. So something I'll admit is that at times my Facebook feed sometimes looks like that. And that's really not a good thing, in my opinion. We really need to think critically about everything we're viewing online, and especially on social media. Scary picture of Nancy Pelosi. Scary picture of the Capitol, something Republicans are doing.
And I guess building off this, how does this fit into the broader topic of free press and democracy? You have politicians on both sides of the aisle, but I mean, currently our administration really wanting to shut down the views on one side or the other. And so it just serves how this polarization, this echo chamber on social media has become normalized and institutionalized by our current administration. And so as much as possible, we really want to realize that we need to move away from this. Like, even as much as we realize the truth in one side or the other and we know where the facts lie, it's important that as consumers of news, we look at both sides and can use both sides to come up with our own views and gauge from the facts where the truth lies. And as journalists, if any of us are part of the press themselves, it's important to realize our responsibility to the truth and not, and for example, with opinion, if
yep.
you are soliciting for editorials, you don't just keep going to progressive people to get editorials, but you go to both sides. I really seek a diversity of narratives on this campus and abroad. And same goes for news when covering it. It's really about, I think ultimately it comes down to giving voice to narratives that aren't always heard, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that should lie one way or another. There are underrepresented voices on any side of the aisle, and we should really move away from recognizing that if we say underrepresented, it's not just a liberal buzzword. There are underrepresented voices on both sides, and really at Princeton we fail to recognize that, and both sides can get attacked. So it's, I guess, a conversation around self-awareness.
Yeah, that's exactly it. I mean, the only thing I want to add to that is, so something I really look for as an opinion editor is to just have as many voices as possible, since we're always going to have disputes about things on this campus. And it's only something like the press where people can really duke it out over their ideas, where you can have this conversation and in something that doesn't matter. And if all we're doing is getting into flame wars on Facebook, what good is that doing for anyone? Right? Like, you'll have commented, people will have like high five, but did that really move the needle on anything?
No. And I guess we really want to segue into a discussion again about, first off, looking at Princeton, moving it inwards to our community, and having a critical, honest discussion about media on our own campus. So some of you might be aware of the vast array of news of media on this campus, some of you might not be aware. So we want to engage. So there's a Daily Princeton, which is a newspaper.
Yep.
We have a bunch of literary publications and political publications, and so really, I guess, being critical of, open the floor to criticisms and reflections on the media on this campus, or perhaps lack thereof. For those, even for those who are not aware, perhaps that's also something to bring in, because that means we should be reaching a greater audience, and we're failing to do that, and we're too insular. So, if anyone wants to kick off conversation, feel free to criticize. I know we're both part of the Prince, but we actually want to hear it.
If you want to criticize the Prince, that's totally fine.
Yeah. Unfiltered.
We're open
off
to
the
it.
Record.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you have nice things to say about the Prince, it's okay too.
to your discussion where you said Facebook's algorithm is designed to kind of lean towards what we would likely click.
Yep.
So I was going to say exactly what you say, where like I use Facebook and I follow everybody. I follow every news source to try and get as many both sides. Or would you use different social media to try and, you know, Twitter or Facebook to help balance that out? So it's not just, you're not forced into Facebook's algorithm. You can maybe bypass that.
You could try.
Is there other social media avenues that we can get all the news from and follow everybody?
One of the aggregators that I personally love is Feedly.
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody else has heard of it, but you don't just get major publications. You can get blogs. You can get some of the things aggregated are actually social media posts by less followed individuals than bloggers, which is pretty remarkable to me. But I think it's cool. You can filter that out as you please, but I think if you are somebody who follows a wide variety of sources along the spectrum, then it's a really good resource to bring some of those into comparison with one another.
I think it's easier with Twitter, but something like that can be sometimes like people, it's 140 characters, so it's not always news. It's like, I mean, you could follow different political figures, Trump versus, I don't know, like it gives you perspective, I think, but it's, I don't know, it's always a resource. And then like, I guess an underrated tool is Instagram, because it can be a great tool for photojournalism increasingly. Mm-hmm. There's actually this account that I found that's following, it's exclusively women photographers, and it looks at different news stories, but like, for example, women who are being under religious persecution in the Middle East, and then that's a book project, or like transgender women in the United States. And so there's different beats, but it's only women photographers. And that's, there are many different initiatives on this on Instagram, but from Time Magazine to National Geographic, like photojournalism is rising. And so the power of that, and Instagram usually is just like, it's seen as like a very millennial tool for just stupid posts, but it's actually, I think, an underrated tool.
Yeah, whatever you get it.
Yeah.
So another thing that, in line with millennial things, that maybe BuzzFeed. I know, like, we don't think, oh, BuzzFeed, like, clickbait, stupid quizzes. But I don't know if this is, like, a recent thing, but on some of their, like, actual news articles, now when you reach the end, they have, like, an outside your bubble thing where they kind of link to other articles that present different views on the same topic.
Yep. Yeah, BuzzFeed News is kind of interesting in a sense. Like, I feel like it's kind of grown apart from the, 26 things this cheese tells about your life or something, sort of quizzes.
It comes up often on MSN.
Yeah, or like, they were really controversial, what was it, last month when they published that dossier from the former intelligence agent guy on, the Trump stuff.
More of a question, I guess, inspired by that you are using, I guess many are using Facebook for their news. Is it really enough just to follow conservative news sites for them to end up in your feed and in your experience, or do you have to be actively engaging or sharing them, or do they still, just by, not liking, but by actually following, is that enough? Enough to recommend to broader student audiences who want to get out of these echo chambers?
Ignorance is bliss. So, I mean, personally speaking, like, I am a very left person, and nothing can change that ultimately. Like, that's internalizing our biases, but I think if anything, being friends with people on this campus who are very much more right than I am has
been much more effective in that, because I mean, I'm following figures who are conservative in a way, but also like, has it inspired a lot of regrettable decisions as far as engaging arguments? Yes, but I think ultimately like, it's changed how I interact, how I engage. It's not just fighting at each other, but actually like, I finally mastered the art of a civil Facebook conversation. So like, and that's a really valued survival too, because then I it took me a few years, but like, I think it's valuable. And I like, with regards to following conservative sources, I think it's a matter of finally getting to the point where like, you'll click on it, not just read the headline, and read it, and then afterwards take a step deeper out or take a step back or whatever, I think, personally speaking, and then engaging with it. So you're right, it's not enough. But I think it's all about personal steps, actually.
Right.
Okay, if anyone else wants to comment on that. So.
Yeah, that's what I mean,
this is interesting because lately we heard that Trump say that the media or the press is the enemy of the people, and that Bush Jr. mentioned that actually the media is very indispensable for democracy because that's a filter to people in power in order not to abuse power. So what do you think about, because we read news every day, we got bombarded by this situation right now. So what do you think about it? Like, is it really media kind of brainwash everybody in some way, some the other? Or like, what is the, after you reading news, what is your perspective after that? Are you taking that, like, oh, this is the facts, this is, a balance, or depends on what kind of news you're reading from?
I think it's more that last point that depends heavily on what it is you're reading, but the fact that different opinions are being expressed, different individuals and organizations might be uncovering facts and information that haven't been brought to light yet is the important democracy thing. And how you kind of synthesize it all together and make your decisions about what actions you're going to take is the real meaning.
Yeah, I guess if I'm going to add to that, my thought is that the media is not necessarily brainwashing people, but only getting things from one source or like taking in a story without questioning it, that is more a form of brainwashing than anything. So that's something that I've taken as a habit lately. So like Sarah, I also lean very far to the left. But I've started looking through Breitbart each day. Because it's, like we saw with the red feed, blue feed, if you're trapped only in the world of the Daily Kos or the Atlantic or some other sort of left-leaning publication, that's the only opinion you're going to get, and that's the only way you might just see the world if you're viewing it through that lens. So that's why I think it's really useful to look through something like Breitbart, because once you cut past the really inflammatory headline about illegal immigrants like kill 5 people and chop up their bodies or something, right? There's something behind that that's much more useful for understanding how other people think and really breaking out of the bubble, right? So like something that, I think is kind of cool lately is like the Pace Center has been giving out all these stickers, right, saying like, burst the orange bubble. And that's, something that we need to consider here, being in Princeton too, right? We live in this bubble. A lot of it is very left-leaning, but just in terms of the kind of place we occupy in society as well, as an Ivy League institution, as, a top-ranked university, that we need to be cognizant of.
A lot of these talks are saying how like Princeton now is so left-leaning. So don't you think that that's just speaking to like your generation? Like, are you left, right? Or like, is that just like, that's how your age group, that's, you're coming up and you're growing into the world, and like maybe that's just speaking to how your generation sees the world versus, someone that's in their 50s or 60s that have like really conservative ideas about, social issues that aren't really of concern to your demographic as much.
Mm-hmm. I think personally it's been interesting because, I come from an immigrant background. My parents are first immigrants from Iran. They're, of course, they're Democrats, but I guess it is also your generational, because still their liberal definition is much different from mine, and I think that's a trend. I mean, not just the immigrant, non-immigrant, but like just the generational divide of, even if your parents are liberal. Again, this is maybe generalization, there are anomalies, but like our definition of liberal or left-wing or progressive, especially in human rights issues, essentially, I think it's different. But I think it's also because of the dissemination of information, the experiences we're having, like LGBT issues and transgender issues wasn't really that at the forefront during my parent generation. Also for them in Iran, like, so it's wasn't that much of an issue, but nowadays it's at the forefront here. When we have the controversy, shouldn't be controversy, but it is, of unisex bathrooms, or like how creating more welcoming space for transgender students. So in some ways, I guess it is generational. It's interesting about the point, someone just brought this up to me today, about how Princeton is the minority or conservative kid supposedly here, and that's a trend towards any college campus, it's not just Princeton, and that's really interesting. But it's also, I think, critically reflecting that that's also not necessarily a good thing, because people from either side, but also who are maybe more moderate, are afraid to speak up. Because oftentimes, like, recognizing this as a liberal, I can be polarizing. And a lot of the liberals on this campus can be polarizing too, on any side. So while it's showing that we're becoming more progressive, whatever that may mean, it's also dangerous. And I think that's something we neglect to realize, especially among our generation. So I'd say.
I don't think it's fair to say that it's just the young generation of students at Princeton who are very liberal. Somebody showed me something a while back. They did polls of faculty, and in several departments there was not a single faculty member who identified as conservative, and not just in departments where you would expect that, like GSS, where you're like, okay, that, like, I can see how that happened, like sociology, there's not a single sociologist at Princeton who identifies as conservative. And by definition, the faculty can't be millennials, maybe, like, the very maybe just the edge of it, but for the most part, that's the one generation up, and it's still overwhelmingly liberal.
I feel like it goes back to the media that's being filtered to you. I grew up in Tennessee, and a lot of the students that I went to high school with, most of the media there that I was exposed to, and also like with my parents when I was growing up, is largely like Republican and conservative. And then coming up north with this, like Princeton, where there's like a large majority of liberal people, it going back to having that nice balance, I feel like both in the north and the south, there is an unbalance when you're growing up. And although you still find like liberals, like I do understand there's like a trend of like younger generations like leaning towards like liberalism, I feel like there wasn't a balance of liberalism and conservatism to like pick your side and actually determine which way you lean or decide to determine the truth.
Do you think there's a balance?
At Princeton, I feel like it is largely liberal. I just like, because, but that's like, it's like a culture shock for me.
Well, if you look at the voting map, it doesn't seem to be a generational thing, but a populated thing. Like, if you're in a city area, that's more blue, and everywhere else seemed to be red. So that goes to your argument. It's not generational, but maybe who you're exposed to on a day-to-day basis.
And I think, you know, personally, so I'm a graduate student. I did my undergrad at Brown, and you know, we had this survey a few years back about faculty and thoughts on student activism, and overall, the faculty at Brown thought that there was that students were less progressive and less activists than they were when they were in college. So I don't know what the environment here is like. And then I spent a year at Berkeley, and obviously, so I think there's always been a history of academia being more progressive, and I think it's just we're shifting the bar of what's considered progressive, right? Like, when we talk about things like gay rights, you know, that those were conversations that we started having in the 70s, and our social norms have kind of caught up to that progressivism, and now we're talking about like trans rights, right? These are new conversations that we're having, and now this is the new bar for being progressive.
I think our notions of liberal and conservative are also very much defined by social liberalism versus conservatism. And I think that when we talk about professors in the sociology department, for example, who, not very many of whom I can also guess this are conservative, if any, then that's sort of a self-selecting thing. But I think if we look at other standards for liberalism and conservatism, then we, for example, in economics, like there are definitely conservative economic thinkers in our department here. So I think it's for good reasons, especially in the last year and a half, social issues have been at the forefront of standards for these camps of thinking. But I think it's also, like, there are other things that exist also besides social politics.
But back to maybe our conversation about the news. So we talk a lot about conservative or liberal sources, but like, what do you think exactly makes a source liberal or conservative?
Depending on who owns the publication, and I don't know if my facts are correct or not, but I've heard that 5 or 6 companies own all the TV and magazines and newspapers. So it boils down to who's the CEO and the board of those 5 or 6 companies is what we're listening to. And there's no other source besides these 5 main companies that own all the media that we listen to. Correct me if I'm wrong, if anyone's heard any different, but I question what's the purpose of the FCC is to monitor our curse words or to keep 5 or 6 people in control of the mass media.
So it's really free press?
Exactly, that's my question, is why can't everyone have their own TV station now that the World Wide Web exists?
I guess citizen journalism is perhaps
trying to do that, because
everyone is
journalist,
right? So I don't know how good
Ben Stoy
is, but I guess
I'm thinking. Well, even if you shifted to, say, an internet-based model, it just changes who's the people in charge. If we stopped watching TV and we started getting all of our news from blogs, for better or worse, now Google owns all the news. Because what's the first page when you Google is what you read, not as opposed to the second page. And Google changes rankings based on all sorts of things. So now we've basically said Google gets to decide what we read, or Facebook gets to decide what we read. So even if you have 1,000 different companies, if you only see the same few, you haven't actually fixed the problem.
And I think it's somewhat free, considering that it's 5 or 6 companies as opposed to one state that dictates things. Now, it's regulated, don't get me wrong there, but still you have some kind of capitalistic influence as opposed to, I don't want to say anything about some of the other countries, but there's certainly places where there's a news authority, and that's the government, and you didn't necessarily even elect those officials.
Do you have a news authority when New York Times and a few other publications are banned from
gaggle or whatever.
Yeah.
And that's another thing. And I even heard that during President Obama's time, there was even some ostracizing Fox or something like that, or some of the more conservative outlets. So, but yeah, I think, yeah, that's actually a very good point. It should be, they shouldn't really have that kind of authority. Perhaps censoring for obscenity, assuming that obscenity isn't all of a sudden obscenity includes anything that's contrary to your viewpoints. But yeah, it should be open, I feel, and free democracy.
That's interesting that you say, like, filtering for obscenity. So, like, for instance, the Daily Smithsonian had a picture this morning on its front page that was, you know, blood and stuff.
It was a deer.
Yes, yeah, not human. But, like, yeah, would that be acceptable under those standards, right?
Well, the reason why I said that is that's what kind of the FCC does. I mean, like on, let's say, television broadcast,
they filter, you know, on public broadcast, not cable, they filter for obscenity.
Right.
And obscenity is generally have become more and more, I guess, liberalized, let's say. But it's still, it's a relatively narrow definition as opposed to being real open, saying, that's a contrary viewpoint to me, therefore it's obscene or terroristic or something like that. And then all of a sudden you think you start to compromise your free press.
I feel like there's a fine line between censoring something that's contrary to your view, because although you don't agree with it, doesn't mean necessarily that they don't have the right to say it. And there's also, there is like that threshold when it goes to actually like legally threatening somebody. Like there is, in censoring, like somebody having the opposing viewpoint to me isn't like threatening legally, like threatening my safety. But to censor things that are actually legally like will harm somebody, like I feel like people are seeing like a contrary viewpoint as something that will like actually like invoke the law against them, and I don't see any harm in it. I feel like it's beneficial to have that contrary viewpoint so that you yourself can take a step back and think about, what do I truly believe, or am I being fed something by like one viewpoint that I choose to follow?
Are there new journalists, like journalist majors?
So we don't have a
journalist. Oh, okay. Something I was hoping you guys would mention. This narrative of these bubbles that are conservative news and liberal news is actually not true, because people are seeing now, I mean, it's somewhat true, of course, but people are seeing now that if you're liberal, you get conservative sources. It really doesn't push you conservative. You just see it as like you're against it, and it like pushes you more liberal. So I think the much bigger issue is that there's just no line between editorial, primary news, secondary news. It's just completely evaporated. And that's something the conservatives are saying too, is that there's no trust in these institutions, because they could be an editorial, it could be a primary news, but you just have no idea. I think conservatives also agree on this point. It's a much bigger issue than the bubbles.
Would you mind explaining what you mean by positive news? Editorial, primary, secondary?
Yeah, like, I mean, there's headline reports, there's editorials. Editorial means, in my opinion, it's not someone who is first reporting the news source, it's someone who's analyzing an event. And there's just, we're completely inundated in pundits, and on election day or any day, you just go on TV and 24 cycle, people talking about, you know, talking heads, you call them. And I think people really place very little value on that, and that's what we're fed with, is something we don't even want. We really just want the news. Conservatives agree on that too. And it's completely evaporated.
I think that's where not enough value subscribe to organizations like ProPublica are like really purely investigative journalism sites that you don't really look at. But yeah, I guess you're completely right, because like folks or a lot of these news sources, like it's news, but it's like, even when it's a fact check piece, it's analysis is injected into it, it's editorialized. So I guess that does reflect, that does require critical reflection of our journals and practices as a paper, but also as anyone who writes, so thank you for bringing that up.
I feel like also being involved in like journalism on campus, I find that with like the code of ethics, like you can't like, you can't have a conflict of interest with what you're doing. But still, even if you're not taking part, like say there's like a protest I want to cover, I don't take part, but like it's a cause that I'm interested in and I still cover it, I feel like that bias is filtered, and that's something I like myself am like very conscious of, like trying to understand like what pieces I'm picking to cover and choose to like report on, because I know that even if there's no conflict of interest, that oftentimes like journalists are choosing things that they are interested in and support.
This question is there such a thing as unbiased journalism, really? So is that something we should be striving for? Even if that's also a question, but
it's acceptable.
Right.
There's a talk on campus last week that Sarah and I both ended up attending by this guy, Jim Carney. And he said a lot of things I agree with him, like varying amounts. But one valuable thing that I thought that he said, or something that I hadn't thought of, was about like reporters or journalists like making their biases known. as in, it's almost easier to put more trust into a story if you know that the person, if the person who is writing it, you know that they have a particular viewpoint and that's what you're reading. And if journalists can make that very transparent in some way, then that is sort of in a different way to eliminate the problem. Instead of like trying to go toward being unbiased, it's sort of completely making transparent where the biases are, as opposed to kind of like trying to hide them and being a, like attempting to be objective.
For me, one question is also, so we've been talking about like having like a balanced cocktail of like news that you take in. But for me, really, I have to say, like, New York Times at the moment doesn't help me like understand a bigger picture, and I'm really see myself being drawn to like longer articles because I feel like, or I guess my question is like, in how far do we have to kind of buy into this rhythm that is dictated by the news that are kind of put out, and like how, or like what's the kind of adequate level of abstraction, I guess, and kind of longer narratives that you like open up. I really struggle with this question. I'm not sure like how I feel like, you know, I'm trying to like get as many facts as like I can, but then I feel like it's totally unsatisfying also, and I just can't answer like the big questions for myself at the moment. Like, I still don't know why this guy was elected. I mean, we all say like, oh, yeah, you know, people left behind, like, what does that even mean? Like, and then of course also like, yeah, I mean, like, I feel like looking at Breitbart and trying to understand the rhetoric and the argument structures and so forth, that helps, but then like, yeah, I don't know if that's a question. Like, I guess my question is, what's the adequate level of like abstraction and like already forming like your own narrative around it? Like, is that something that you struggle with at all? Like, I feel like just increasing the amount of news that I get is like, I'm overwhelmed by that, and I don't feel that it makes me understand a lot more.
That's not something like our vision struggle with, or like any newspapers, like that struggle between people have short attention spans nowadays.
Yeah.
So it's like,
yeah.
Wants,
and also like realistically, I can't. Yeah. I mean, maybe that's also like a pathetic excuse for me, but still, like, I can't spend 2 hours in the morning,
right,
like researching every site.
I find a lot of stories don't do the who, what, where, when, why, like there's gaps.
Uh-huh.
So wait, why did that happen? And they're not answering that question,
yeah.
So I feel equally as frustrated.
Yeah.
And it's like the struggle to me, is it about always keeping up, trying to put out news, just like little blurbs and headlines,
yeah.
Or is it about taking the time, perhaps not being the first one to report on a topic and getting a story,
yeah.
And putting out a longer form analysis piece?
Yeah.
So at least I'm struggling with the journalism industry,
yeah.
For sure,
yeah.
Right, even as a consumer.
Yeah.
And also find the time to find that article that just
this is similar to what you're saying, perhaps, but I was just thinking about this with this whole Russia connections thing. We're in this news cycle, and yet there's still almost no information about it. And yet we're just going to be talking, and it's really, read it, it really doesn't make you any more informed. And just a nonstop discussion about nothing, essentially. Yep.
Sorry. Yeah, I guess it's more of a question. I'm not quite sure how to formulate, but I'm wondering if you or any others thought about what role, if any, universities and students in particular can have as a voice in this issue, where over the next 4 years and maybe longer, so I think about that yet, where we have this contradiction where we need to be critical of the media in terms of how we're consuming it, and you know, possibly encouraging unbiased journalism through and on the other hand, how we may need to also be, you know, unusually supportive of the media in some ways, when you have an administration that's trying to delegitimize certain, you know, news agencies in particular by calling them fake news, and you know, they call it the authoritarian playbook, where you, one by one, you
delegitimize a news agency, and you know, it's I know it's a different story in the U.S., but that's how, like, you know, we've digressed in other societies. And so, yeah, I guess, I don't know, have you thought of what role students could have in that conversation?
Clearly,
the answer is no, we haven't. That's fine. Yeah. I don't know, I thought in terms of what a university can do, I'm sure so much institutionally. But as individual students, my advice is go and get involved in whatever publication you think suits you best. We'll put a plug out for the Daily Princeton. Yeah, we're always taking more writers. But if there's something else that you think better suits what you want to do, there are plenty of opportunities here. Going to do something, and Princeton has enough resources to kind of throw it in the individual way.
There's a platform, medium.com, for lawyer, but it's a lot of, there's new stuff, there's also personal merits and such, and anyone can write on it, and I think it's a great platform for, I've gone over personal merits and such, but there's also great reporting on it, and I feel like finding platforms such as that to share your voice and write pieces on it is also, even like social, like I know social media. I know like one friend is an independent student here. Doesn't eat a dining hall or eating club. She wrote about some of the concerns independent students have on campus and how frustrated she was. And based on that, one of our news reporters, like I saw that on my feed as her friend, took it to a news reporter, and then she did an investigative piece on it. So like, I guess that's news in itself. So like, really utilizing the tools and platforms that are out there to just raise your voice.
I was also thinking, I mean, maybe we also have to learn more how to, like, read media totally differently, like, because we were talking about truth earlier, I'm not actually sure, because truth didn't play, like, a really big role in this election, right? So I'm, like, thinking, maybe we just have to, like, also start and, like, read pieces of, yeah, like, I don't know, go to Breitbart and read it and see, like, how the rhetorics of this is and how the agitation actually works, like, how these texts, like, turn on particular affects or not, or things like that. Like, maybe we have to, like, I don't know, try and also engage in a different kind of reading that's not looking for, like, truth or, like, fact-checking these things, but, like, reading them for their, like, rhetorical, and, like, yeah, for their, like, how they turn on affects and how they, like, agitate people. Because I feel like, I don't know, it's also kind of, like, why, like, I mean, I'm being polemic now, but, like, why should I read? Like, why should I, like, try and, like, really, like, find this truth? And, like, most of the people, like, they don't care anyway. And, But doesn't it, like, make the split even bigger if we're, like, truth? And then, like, people are just, like, I don't know, there are just some pieces out there that are, like, total bullshit, but are just really good at making people angry or feeling insecure or whatever it is. So I feel like ignoring that and like kind of filtering that out of my bubble because it's not truth, it's kind of also not the solution for me.
That's a good one to wrap up the discussion on. I guess really trying to change the way we read the media and wherever that may be, looking at emotions or the agitations in the piece. But thank you all so much for coming. I hope you guys had some time to at least reflect, but really appreciate it.
Thanks everyone. Yeah.